And there are two people from Portugal. They are from the University of Lisboa, but I think their university is not exactly downtown, but it's close to Lisboa. And you can see the talk, the title, Ranks of Monoids on Endomorphisms, Partial Automorphisms, and Injective Partial Endomorphism of Finite Indirect Paths. Okay, please.
Thank you. Dear colleagues, first of all, thank you very much for your interest in my talk. And I would like to thank Academic Drensky for the invitation to give a talk on this seminar. As he said already, the talk is a joint work with our colleague Jörg Koppitz from the Institute of Mathematics and Informatics, and two colleagues from Portugal, Vitor Fernandes and Teresa Quinteiro. So I will speak about some monoids of endomorphisms, partial automorphisms, and injective partial endomorphisms on finite undirected path. First, I will start with some introductions. In the same way that automorphisms of graphs allow to establish natural connections between graph theory and group theory, endomorphisms of graphs do the same between graph theory and semigroup theory. And also partial automorphisms of graphs relates graph theory with inverse semigroup theory. For this reason, that monoids of endomorphisms of graphs have been attracting the attention of several authors over the last decades. In fact, from combinatorial properties to more algebraic concepts have been extensively studied. Regularity in the sense of semigroup theory is one of the most studied notions. Regular semigroups constitutes a very important class in semigroup theory. A general solution to the problem posed in 1988 by Markey, of which graphs have a regular monoid of endomorphisms, seems to be very difficult to obtain. But for some special classes of graphs, various authors studied and solved this question. Another very important notion in the semigroup theory, this is the rank of the semigroup and monoid especially. What mean this rank? Rank of the monoid S is the least number of generators of S, and we focus our attention in this research on this important notion of semigroup theory. So let omega be a finite set with at least two elements. It's well known that the symmetric group of omega has rank 2. The monoid of all full transformations of omega has a rank 3. The monoid of all partial transformations of omega has rank 4, and the symmetric inverse monoid of omega has rank 3 again. The survey made by Fernandes in 2002 present these results and similar ones for other classes of transformation monoids, in particular for monoids of order preserving transformations and some of the extensions. And recently, many papers are dedicated to the computation of rank of certain semigroups or monoids. Now we said that we'll give a connection between semigroup theory and graph theory. So let G be a simple graph. This means undirected graph without loops and without multiply edges. V is the set of the vertices, and E is the set of the edges. let alpha be a partial transformation of V and denote by dom alpha the domain of alpha and im alpha the image of alpha. So we consider the following type of transformations. First, we consider a partial endomorphism of G. This is endomorphism for which if UV is an H in the set E, implies that the image U alpha and V alpha is also an H in the set E. And this is for all U and V in the domain of alpha. A weak partial endomorphism of G is defined in the following way. If U and V belongs to E and U alpha is different from V alpha, then we have U alpha and V alpha belongs to E again for all UV in the domain of alpha. The strong endomorphism of G is if UV belongs to E, if and only if U alpha V alpha belongs to the set of edges E. A strong weak endomorphism is similar, but here again, like in the definition of weak endomorphism, we have the condition for strong endomorphism additional with the with the condition that U alpha is different from V alpha. So this means that in the case of weak partial endomorphism and strong weak endomorphisms, we can have different elements UV with the same image. A partial automorphism of G is if alpha is an injective mapping and alpha and the inverse of alpha are both partial endomorphisms. So I give here the definition for partial case, but the same definition we have in the full case of the mapping. And if alpha is a full mapping, instead of partial endomorphism, we'll say only endomorphisms. And then it is clear that the domain of alpha will be will coincide with the set V. Same for the others definitions. Weak partial endomorphisms, we will say weak endomorphism. For partial automorphisms, we should say automorphisms. Now, denote in the following way the monoids that we are considering. WP end of G is the monoid of all weak partial endomorphisms. P end of G is partial endomorphisms. End of G are all endomorphisms. W end is weak endomorphisms. I end is the set of injective partial endomorphisms. P out is the set of all partial automorphisms. S end are strong endomorphisms. SW end is strong weak endomorphisms, and out J is the automorphisms of G. Clearly, this is all these sets are monoids, and for instance, the last three monoids, the results for them quite basic, and we will say just a little things about them in the first chapter for with some basic properties. Our attention is focused over these four monoids. First, we consider the monoids of endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms. This is the case when the transformations are full transformations. And in the partial case, we consider the injective endomorphisms and partial automorphisms. The first two monoids So partial endomorphisms and weak partial endomorphisms are still open problems. So here we have the following inclusions in this monoids. The monoid of automorphisms is a submonoid of strong endomorphisms. It is submonoid of endomorphisms and it's submonoid of weak endomorphisms. Also, we have another inclusions here connected with the strong weak endomorphisms. You see that here we don't have this monoid, but here we have automorphisms, a subset of strong endomorphisms, subset of strong weak endomorphisms, and subset of weak endomorphisms. In the partial case, we have that the partial automorphism is a submonoid of injective endomorphisms, which is a submonoid of partial endomorphisms, and it is a submonoid of weak partial endomorphisms. I will show some pictures of these inclusions. For instance, first in this case, when we have strong endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms. Just to see here this one. You can see here when we have n elements, we obtain the elements of the semigroup of weak endomorphisms with the blue elements with strong endomorphisms, which coincides here with the automorphisms. Also, we have blue plus red here in the last line. This is a strong weak endomorphisms, and the whole one is the monoid of weak endomorphisms. Just to see here for five elements, we have something like that. In the case when I'm trying to do something here. I cannot open the set because there's something over my. Okay. Okay. Now, this is an example in the case when we have strong endomorphisms. The blue one.
You stopped sharing your screen. Could you share it again?
Because
we don't see it.
Sorry. Just to see what happened. Okay. Sorry, when I try to move between the files and I have something in the top of the window that is a little bit covered my files and touch the stop sharing button in incident. Okay, so this is the example for strong endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms. In the case of four elements, the blue one are strong endomorphisms, then blue plus red are endomorphisms, and the whole one is the weak endomorphisms. In the partial cases, for instance, injective endomorphisms and partial automorphisms. With four elements, we have here the red part is a partial automorphism, and the whole picture gives us the injective endomorphisms. Here's one picture for five elements. You can see how looks this. These pictures are made by GAP program. Okay. So let now n be the set of all natural numbers and Pn be the undirected path with n vertices. The number of endomorphisms of the path Pn has been determined by R1 and also by Michels and Knauer. In addition, several other combinatorial algebraic properties of Pn were also studied in these papers. Here we will show the cardinality of the semigroup of weak endomorphisms. Actually, we showed the cardinality of automorphisms, strong endomorphisms, strong weak endomorphisms, and weak endomorphisms. But as I said before, the automorphisms, strong endomorphisms, and strong weak endomorphisms are quite trivial. So more important formula is for weak endomorphisms. Then we have a formula for partial automorphisms and injective endomorphisms. But our main objective, as I said in the beginning, is the rank of these monoids. So we show that the rank of weak endomorphisms is exactly this number. The rank of the endomorphisms of Pn is this number. And for the partial cases, for partial automorphisms, we have that it is equal to 2. In the case of both monoids, for n equal 1 and 2, it's equal to the rank of partial automorphism is 3 for n equal 3 and n minus 1 for n greater than or equal 4. And for rank of injective endomorphisms, we have that it's equal 4 for n equal 3 and n plus n over 2 minus 2 for n greater than or equal 4. Moreover, not only the ranks and cardinalities are described in this research, but we also give some properties about the regularity and Green's relations of some of these monoids. First, we start with some basic properties. Now let n be a natural number, and with n over line, we will denote the set of all natural numbers from 1 until n with the usual order. The undirected path with n vertices can be considered like following simple graph. The set of vertices is n over line. And the set of edges is this set I plus 1 for I from 1 until n minus 1. So for two elements u and v, it's clear that u, v is an edge of the path Pn if and only if the absolute value of u minus v is equal 1. So clearly we have this description of the elements in the monoid of weak endomorphisms and of endomorphisms of Pn. First, let alpha be a full transformation. Alpha belongs to the monoid of weak endomorphisms of Pn if and only if the absolute value of the difference I alpha minus I plus 1 alpha is less than or equal 1 for I from 1 until n minus 1. So in this case, it's possible that I and I plus one have the same images, and in that situation, this number will be equal zero. In the case of endomorphisms, it's not possible to have zero because it's not possible to have the same images for I alpha and I plus one alpha. So in that case, we have that the difference between these images, I alpha and I plus one alpha, should be equal one. Also, for the elements in the monoid of weak endomorphisms, we have the following property. If I is an interval of n, then I alpha also is an interval of n. And in particular, we have that the image of alpha is an interval of n. Now I will say some basic properties about strong endomorphisms and strong weak endomorphisms. First, let alpha be an element from the automorphisms of Pn. Let one alpha, the image of one is equal to I. Then for two alpha, we have only two possibilities, to be equal to I minus one or I plus one. And since alpha is a permutation of n, if 2 alpha is equal to I plus 1, then we have that 3 alpha is I plus 2, and so on, n minus I plus 1 alpha is equal n, and so we should obtain that n minus I plus 1 is equal n. Otherwise, we will obtain that two elements have the same image, n minus 1, which is not possible. And so in this case, we obtain that I is equal 1 and alpha coincides with the identity mapping. On the other hand, if we take that 2 alpha is I minus 1, first we consider it the situation that 2 alpha is I plus 1. Now we take the other possibilities, I minus 1. Then for 3 alpha, we have I minus 2, and so on. For I alpha, we will have the image 1. In this case, I will be equal to n, and we obtain that alpha is the permutation with reversing order. You see, the image is from n up to 1. So in this situation, we obtain that the automorphisms of Pn have only two elements. These two elements are the identity mapping and the reversing mapping. To say about the elements in the monoid of strong endomorphisms, we need this definition. Defined by N of U, the set of all vertices V such that U and V is an H in the set E. We say that this is the neighbors of the element U. Binary relation RG on V is defined by the following property, that UV belongs to this binary relation if and only if the neighbors of U are the same like the neighbors of V. So for n different free, it is easy to check that this binary relation is identity. And so using one property from the book of Knauer, algebraic graph theory, we obtain that the strong endomorphisms of Pn coincides with the automorphisms of Pn for all n different from free. What happens when n is equal 3? When we have n equal 3, we obtain that the strong endomorphisms of P3 have exactly these six elements. This, the first two elements are the same like in the automorphism of Pn, but the next four elements are additional. And it is possible to have these elements only for n equal 3. So in this case, the automorphisms are proper submonoid of the strong endomorphisms. And in this, and here, the strong endomorphisms are generated by two elements. First one is a permutation with reverse order, reversing order, and the second one is one transformation with rank two. So we have the strong, the monoid of strong endomorphisms. The monoid of strong endomorphisms are generated by two elements for P3 and by one element in the case of n different free. And in this case, we have that the rank of the monoid of strong endomorphisms is equal to for n equal free and one for n different from free. Now consider the strong weak endomorphisms. We can see that the monoid of strong weak endomorphisms have the elements of the strong endomorphisms plus the constant mappings. So for the case when n is different free, we will have two permutations and n constant mappings. In case when n is equal three, then we have the six elements from here for the strong endomorphisms. You can see these six elements here plus three constant mappings. And so here is easy to show that this strong weak endomorphism is generated by three elements in the case when n is equal three. And by these elements in the case when n is different free. So here for the constant mappings, we need just the half of them. And the rank of the strong weak endomorphisms will be equal to n over 2 plus 1. So now we will focus over the other monoids. First, consider the full monoids of endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms, and consider the regularity for this for these monoids. Recall first that an element of a semigroup S is called regular if there exists X in S such that S is equal to S XS. A semigroup is said to be regular if all elements of the semigroup are regular. Since the automorphism of G is a group, then it's trivially a regular monoid. By above properties that we say about the strong endomorphisms and strong weak endomorphisms, it is clear that they are also regular monoids. For the monoids of endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms, but this is not true, and we have characterization of the regular elements. So first, let alpha is an element from the monoid of weak endomorphisms or from the monoid of the endomorphisms. Then alpha is regular if and only if there exists an interval I of n such that I alpha is equal to the image of alpha and the number of elements in this interval I is equal with the number of elements in the image of alpha. It is routine to check that the monoid of endomorphisms Pn is regular for n less than or equal 5, and the monoid of weak endomorphism is regular for n less than or equal 3. If we have in the first case n greater than 5 and in the second one greater than 3, then we don't have regular monoids. It's easy to see that, for instance, this element here is not a regular element of the endomorphisms, endomorphism monoid. And this one here, it's easy to check that is not a regular element in the weak endomorphisms. So as a corollary, we have that the monoid of weak endomorphism is regular if and only if n is less than or equal 3, and the monoid of endomorphisms of Pn is regular if and only if n is less than or equal 5. Another important notion in the semigroup theory is green relations, and here we consider a green relations for the partial monoids, partial automorphisms and injective endomorphisms. First, recall what mean Green's relations L, R, and J for monoid S. So here we have that alpha and beta L related if and only if there exist the transformation elements, sorry, here S is arbitrary monoid. There exist elements gamma and delta of S such that alpha is equal to gamma beta and beta is equal to delta alpha. For R related, we have that alpha is equal to beta gamma prime and beta is equal to alpha delta prime. And for J related, if and only if there exist transformations elements gamma, gamma prime, delta, delta prime in S, such that alpha is equal to gamma, beta, gamma prime, and beta is equal to delta, alpha, delta prime. So if we consider one inverse semigroup, then for the Green's relations, L, R, and H, I forget to say that the H relation is the intersection between L and R. And in the case of finite monoid, relation G and D coincides. So now if we take two inverse transformations, alpha and beta, they will be L related if and only if they have the same images. They are R related if they have the same domain, and H related if and only if they have the same images and the same domain. So the monoids of partial automorphisms of Pn and injective endomorphisms of Pn are submonoids of the symmetric inverse monoid En. So and also the partial automorphisms are inverse semigroup. So in this case, for partial automorphisms, the relation L, R, and H should be the same like in the inverse semigroup En. And here we have just to describe the J relation G. On the other hand, for the monoid I and injective endomorphisms, we have that this is not inverse semigroup. And so in this case, we should consider all J, all Green's relations L, R, H, and J. So he's given an example that this element is one element from the monoid of injective endomorphisms, but it is not a regular element. So we will describe the Green's relations, all Green's relations for the monoid of injective endomorphisms. First, we need the following definitions. For set X subset of N, set I subset of X is called the maximal interval of X if I satisfies the following properties. First, I is an interval of X. this means that if x and y belongs to I and z belongs to n with the property that x is less than z less than y, this implies that z should be also in I. And to be maximal, we have that if j is a subset of x, is an interval of x, then I is a subset of j implies that they should be coincide, should be equal. Also here we need the definition of order preserving and order reversing transformation, and recall that one transformation is order preserving if x less than y implies that the image of x, x alpha, is less than or equal to y alpha, and it is order reversing if we have for x less than y implies that the images x alpha is greater than or equal to y alpha. For inverse transformation alpha, we have the following observations. Alpha belongs to the monoid of injective endomorphisms if and only if for each interval I of the domain of alpha, the image of I alpha, the image I alpha is an interval of the image of alpha. If alpha is injective endomorphism, then alpha is order preserving or order reversing in the interval I for each interval in the domain of alpha. If for each maximal interval of the domain of alpha, the image of this interval is also an interval of the image of alpha, and alpha is order preserving or order reversing in this interval I, then alpha will be injective endomorphism. If alpha is a partial automorphism and I is a maximal interval of the domain of alpha, then the image of this interval I alpha is a maximal interval of the image of alpha. If for each maximal interval I of the domain of alpha, the image I alpha is a maximal interval of the image of alpha, and alpha is order preserving or order reversing in I, then we have that alpha is one partial automorphism of Pn. Now let x1, xk be a partition of domain of alpha, and we will use this notation of alpha to express that yi is image of xi alpha for I from 1 to k. And now we can give a definition of, we can give a propositions for the Green's relations. First, we consider the L relation in the case of injective endomorphisms. Let alpha and beta be two transformations in the monoid of injective endomorphisms of Pn, and let I1, I2, Ik, and I1 prime, I2 prime, IL prime be maximal intervals of domain of alpha and domain of beta respectively. Then the following conditions are equivalent. Alpha and beta are L related. Then the set of the images of the intervals of the domain of alpha, I1 alpha, I2 alpha, Ik alpha, should be equal to the set of the images of the intervals in the domain of beta, I1 prime beta, I2 prime beta, IL prime beta. Moreover, we have here that the image of alpha is equal to the image of beta, and the product of alpha and inverse of beta should be one transformation in the monoid of partial automorphisms. Here we should mention that this transformation beta minus one, the inverse of beta, cannot be element from the injective endomorphisms. But this that we need is that the product of these two transformations is one partial automorphism. About the R relation, we have that alpha and beta are related, even only if they have the same domain, and the transformation alpha minus one beta is a partial automorphism. For the H relation, we have that it is an intersection between R and L relations. So we have here that two transformations from the injective endomorphisms are H related, if and only if they have the same domains, the same images, and the transformations alpha minus one beta and alpha beta minus one are partial automorphisms. Now it's remain to show the Green's relation G on the both monoids of injective endomorphisms and partial automorphisms. First, we need the following notations here. For two subsets A and B of N, we say that A is less than B any element from A is less than any element from B. The sequence A equal to A1AP of elements of N will be denoted in this way. And we define the reverse of this sequence to be the following sequence AR, which we start with the last element AP until the first one A1. Now let alpha be an element from the monoid of injective endomorphisms and G be a maximal interval of the image of alpha. Define the type of G to be a sequence tau alpha of G of number of elements in the intervals I1, I2, IP, which are maximal intervals of J alpha minus one. And also we order this sequence in the way such that I alpha, the image of II, is less than the image of II plus one alpha for I between one and P. Now, for two transformations, alpha and beta, we say that they have the similar type. If there exists a bijection sigma from the set of all maximal intervals of the image of alpha into the set of maximal intervals of image of beta, such that the type of G in alpha belongs to the set of these two types, type of beta, type of G sigma with beta, and the reverse one of G sigma with beta. So tau of G in alpha, the type of this interval G in alpha, should be the same like in some interval G sigma in beta, or the reverse one of this interval. So we have that the two transformations have similar type, if and only if they have maximal intervals of their images with the same type, up to the reversion and the same number of occurrences. And now we can say that for two transformations alpha and beta in the injective endomorphisms, we have we take that alpha and beta have similar type. Then there exist gamma and delta in the partial automorphisms, such that beta is equal to gamma alpha delta, and alpha is equal to the inverse of gamma, gamma minus one, beta, delta minus one. Using this lemma here, we can say that alpha and beta are J-related in the injective endomorphisms, even only if they have a similar type. About the partial automorphism, results comes as a corollary from the lemma and proposition before, since the partial automorphism is an inverse semigroup and it is a submonoid of the injective endomorphisms. We obtain here that alpha and beta are J-related, again, if and only if they have a similar type. So, we describe the Green's relations for both monoids of injective endomorphisms and partial automorphisms. Now about the cardinality. Actually, I don't have so much time. Maybe I have more things that I can show. But just a little bit about the cardinality. For the automorphisms, when n is equal 1, automorphisms of P1, strong endomorphisms of P1, strong weak endomorphisms of P1, endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms are equal 1. The elements in this monoids, I mean, they have just one element. For n equal 2, or greater than or equal 4, about the automorphisms and strong endomorphisms, we have two elements. And about strong weak endomorphisms, we have n plus 2 elements. So this is that we said in the basic properties that automorphisms and strong endomorphisms have only two elements, the identity and the reversing transformation. And strong weak endomorphisms have these two elements plus the constant mapping, which are n exactly. If we have n equal 3, then the situation is following. The automorphisms of P3 is equal 2. The number of elements in the strong endomorphisms of P3 are 6, and in the strong weak endomorphisms are equal 9. Formula about the number of elements in the endomorphisms of Pn was given by Arlon in 2009. And regarding the monoid of weak endomorphisms of Pn, we have the formula below. To define this formula, we need to define recursively some family of integers. We denote by A of Ri. R is between 1 and 10 minus 2, and I is between 1 and 10 minus 1. Then we have the following integers that we need in the formula. I will not explain everything, don't have enough time. But using these definitions here, we obtain the formula for the elements in the weak endomorphisms of Pn, which is exactly this number. And with the table below, you can see how is the number of elements in this monoid with n from 1 until 16 is here. But this formula gives us the possibilities to calculate the number of elements in this monoid even for larger n. For example, if n is equal 100, we have this number of elements. You can see that we can calculate very big numbers. Now about the cardinality of the partial automorphisms and injective endomorphisms. We need some definitions here. About this formula. And using these numbers, we obtain in this theorem the number of elements in these both monoids. Now, to say something about the generators and rank of the monoids. First, we consider the monoids of endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms. And just shortly, I will say the generating set of the monoid of endomorphisms contain the transformation tau. You can see this is a permutation with the reversing order. Then we have here transformations alpha I, in which we have in this point I plus one, the image is equal one, and in this direction, left, we increase the elements from one, two, three, I until I plus one. And here in this situation, also from one, two until n minus I. Using these elements, here alpha I is defined from one until n minus two, but we will see that we need just the half of these transformations alpha I. And defining the set tau, just to see, yes, tau with alpha I for I from one until n minus one over two, and also the transformations beta ji, in which we have the identity mapping until I plus J plus one. Then here we start with I plus J. Can see increase the elements until here and then start to take less than one. Can see here and here we have the same images. Using these transformations beta ji, we define it from one until n minus three j minus two, but it's happened later that in the generating set of the monoid, we need just the half of them. And so here define the set A with dimension transformations tau alpha I, and now this beta j I for j from one until n minus three over three, and I from one until n minus three j minus one over two, we obtain that this set A is a generating set of the monoid of all endomorphisms. The number of elements in this set is calculated to be this number here. And later we show that this set A is a minimal generating set of the monoid of endomorphisms. And this shows us that that number exactly is the rank of the monoid of all endomorphisms, the path Pn. About the partial automorphisms, about the weak endomorphisms, additional to these elements of the set A, we need transformations gamma I. These transformations are not endomorphisms, because here we have two elements, I and I plus one, with the same image, I and I. This can happen in the monoid of weak endomorphisms, but not in the monoid of the endomorphisms. And so using these transformations gamma I, additional to the transformations that we defined already here in the set A, we obtain the set B with this elements and show that this set B is a generating set for the weak endomorphisms of PN. Calculate that the number of this set is the number of elements in this set is exactly this one, and then show that this generating set B is of minimal size. So we cannot take a set which is less than B and generate the monoid of weak endomorphisms. And then this shows that this number is the rank of the weak endomorphisms of PN. About the generators and rank of the partial case of partial automorphisms and injective endomorphisms, we use these transformations. Again, we need the permutation tau with reversing order. And here we take transformations alpha I, which are defined in this way. Until I minus one, we have the identity mapping. And then from I plus one until N, we have the reversing part. So I is missing in the domain and in the image. If we take these transformations, tau and tau for I, we obtain that this set with tau alpha 1 and alpha 2 is a generating set in the case when n is equal 3 for the partial automorphisms. And if we take tau with the elements alpha I for I from 1 until n minus 2 for n greater than or equal 4, we obtain that this set A is a generating set of the partial automorphisms. So now I will skip this. These are special transformations which we need to prove that this is a generating set, but just we'll go on about the rank. So here I said that we prove that this set A is generating for the partial automorphisms. And then we show that this is a minimal generating set and obtain the rank of this monoid. To calculate the rank of the injective endomorphisms of PN, we need additional this type of transformations, beta I. For beta I, what is special things here? From 1 until I minus 1, we have again the identity mapping. Then from I plus 1 until N, we have the images with one less. Exactly here, I plus 1, the image is I, and so on. And you can see here that the image of this transformation here is one interval. We have in the image I minus one, I plus one, and this interval is from one until n minus one. This situation we don't have in the partial automorphisms, but we have in the injective endomorphisms. So we need additional these transformations beta I. And obtain the set B with the transformations which we need for the partial automorphisms, additional with this beta I for I from 2 until n over 2. We show that this set B is a generating set of the injective endomorphisms, and the number, and it is a generating set with the minimal size, and obtain that the rank of injective endomorphisms for p equal 3 is equal to 4, and for n greater than equal 4, we obtain that the rank of the injective endomorphisms is n plus n over 2 minus 2. And I skip somewhere the theorem for the partial, just to find it, sorry. Ah, here. The rank for the partial automorphisms, if n is equal to 3, then we have that the rank of the partial automorphism is also 3. And for n greater than or equal 4, the rank is n minus 1. So I'm sorry, I'm a little bit late. Just to say that these results are published in two papers. First one is for the full transformations of endomorphisms and weak endomorphisms. And it is from last year, published in the Bulletin of the Malaysian Mathematical Science Society. And the last one is quite new. It was published online in Semigroup Forum 10 days ago. And it is for the partial cases, for partial automorphisms and injective partial endomorphisms. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yes, we thank the speaker for the interesting talk. Do you have any questions or comments? You can simply speak without raising hand, etc., because we are not too many people.
Well, may I make a very superficial, somewhat double-edged comment? I'm impressed you fit so much technical detail in this talk. I'm impressed. It's beyond my ability to do a similar thing. So much technical detail.
Thank you. I was trying. I was trying to say many things, and now I realize that it is not a good idea. Maybe I have to do this in two different talks for the both cases, in full and partial cases. I hope that I focus on the main things.
Okay, there is a Russian proverb that from the trees you cannot see the forest, but I think that now your talk is a counterexample to this statement.
Yes. Thank you.
Yes. Oh, okay. Yes, true.
Some other questions?
Okay, maybe I can say some things.
Yeah, sure. You're one of the co-speakers, so you have the right.
Yes. Maybe can you say some things about ideas for further research in this subject? Do you have some ideas what we can do in this direction with PARS or such things in the future? Have you some ideas?
So here we consider the situation for the paths, but there is many different graphs that we can consider in such algebraic way. For instance, we have some results connected with the fences. Now we are working with Jörg over the crowns and so, as I said in the beginning, the partial case of these partial endomorphisms and weak partial endomorphisms is still open problem. So I think that here for the connection between graphs and semigroup, there is a lot of things that we can work.
Okay, Dimitrinka Vladeva, she has a question. Is this work something, some application to our automata theory? This in the chat.
Sorry, I cannot see here the chat. Maybe. Okay. I don't know. I'm not sure. We consider the problem from the semigroup theory point of view and focus on the things which are important in the semigroup theory, like regularity, Green's relations, and ranks. But I think that it should be connected with automaton theory, because the graph theory and automata is something very close. So.
Well, there is a famous theorem in automata which takes one semester to teach in terms of semigroups. There the issue is how big an automaton you are getting when you start decomposing an arbitrary one into a special form. The Kron-Rhodes theorem. It says that the transition table of any automata can be decomposed into one which consists of permutations for fixed letters and mappings which either glue some, either identify some elements or leave them unchanged. Yeah, something like that. And this kind of automata are composed. So this is typically taught in semigroup notation, and it takes a semester to teach to students. Yeah. So you're excused for the detail. Yes, it's
some other questions or yeah. Comments? If no, yes, thank the speaker once again. And I have a couple of announcements. First, on Monday.
Thank you very much again for your attention.
On Monday in Hungary, Budapest, there will be a talk in the algebra seminar. So if you enter the homepage of the Reni Institute of Mathematics in Hungary, you can see the abstract. The people who are in our list, they know about the talk. Also, the next Friday, we also have a talk. The talk is in the same time, 1 p.m. Bulgarian time. And the talk is by Michael Vonley. This is on finite groups. You can see this in the homepage of the seminar about the abstract, the password, et cetera, et cetera. So you're welcome to these two talks. If no more comments, you can simply stay for chat.
Yeah, Elisa can terminate the
yes,
recording.
Yes, I was just going to say the same thing. I'm stopping the recording.
Okay.